Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 5 of In the Pocket with Chip G. And I am your host, Kevin Chip Ginyard. I am Chip G, 203 Chip G. I bring you greetings from Atlanta, Georgia, by way of Bridgeport, Connecticut. So that's where the 203 comes from. This is my podcast, and we're on episode 5. And I'm excited about tonight because I get to sit down with an icon, a legend from where I'm from in our small state of Connecticut. But he has also touched the world through music, through the power of music. Let's talk about what being in the pocket is. Like James Brown, the funky drummer, the drum track is a perfect example of finding your groove. It's locking in and doing what feels best to support the song, the acting role, or the art that you're creating. This podcast was created to provide information and advice for upcoming artists, musicians, background singers, songwriters, producers, and so on and so forth. We want to give you the game. We want to help you understand what it means to get into the industry and what it takes to get into the industry and then stay and have a successful career in the business. So I'm excited about tonight because I get to sit down with this guy. He's big stuff. He's not just a normal, regular producer. This is a super producer. If you heard my promotion this week, I've been saying super producer Troy Oliver. Super producer because this guy has touched the world through the power of his music. And he's very humble, he's very likable and very relatable, and we're going to get to know his story. He's going to tell us how he sustained a successful career in this music business for over the last 25 years. And he's a young man, and guess what? Tomorrow's his birthday, so we get to celebrate his birthday a day in advance. So I'm so happy that he took time out of his busy schedule to come on and be my guest on my show, Episode 5, with super producer Troy Oliver. Welcome to the show, bro.
You. What's good, man?
What's up?
Good, man. Thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
No problem, man. You are a behind-the-scenes guy. You know, we don't see you all in the limelight, all in the videos. You know what I mean? You are a laid-back dude. So I really appreciate you doing this. Thank you for doing that.
No doubt, man. Anytime.
So hailing from our home state, right? We're from Connecticut. We both are in Atlanta now, but we're mm-hmm. originally from Connecticut. So I'm honored to sit down with you. You're a father, a super producer, a seasoned musician that's created a name in the industry that commands respect. And it's Gemini season as well. So tomorrow's your birthday tomorrow. So we want to celebrate you, man. So happy birthday to you, bro.
Happy birthday in advance, man. Thank you. Bless.
This show is to give people, and I was telling you in the green room, this show is to help mm-hmm. people find their way. And what better way than the people that have done it and, you know, paved the way. That have been in the trenches, have gone from every stage in the game from, you know, entry level to success. And mm-hmm. so we just want to hear your story and you can drop some gems and help us find our groove, find our niche, help us get in the pocket and stay there. Musical term in the pocket is when you find that beat, that groove, and you lock in and you stay right there. We don't mean stay right there in your ability, but stay right there as far as your mentality, grinding, pushing, you know, to mm-hmm. succeed. So I just want to celebrate some of the people that I have connections to and I have networked with that can help these people, you know, aspire to do better and find their groove and find their niche. So thank you for doing this. And let's get right into it, bro. You ready?
Let's go.
So let's give a little background story. Let's talk about, you know, we're both from Connecticut. So mm-hmm. how was it growing up in Connecticut?
Connecticut, as you know, is funny story. A lot of funny stories. You know, we live in Atlanta now. I'm actually on the outskirts of Atlanta. They say I live in Africa when I tell people where I live.
I live in Georgia, right?
Yeah, not that far. Yeah. I'm not going to say the time because I'm people too nosy. I don't want
exactly,
to
play all there,
but I live out there. But yeah, so whenever I meet someone, you know, randomly in a restaurant or just meet someone new, like, where are you from? This happened a couple of days ago. I'm from Connecticut. I'm sitting down eating, and a couple of young ladies over there talking to me. My boy, like, where you from? So I'm from Connecticut. She's like, is black people in Connecticut?
Absolutely. Every day of my life,
yeah,
bro.
Yeah. So, you know, we don't, you know, Connecticut is not really recognized too much worldly, but in the country. Like, you know, people are shocked when they say you're from Connecticut. You know, you black. Oh, and you cool black. You're not like bougie. Like, you know, you're not.
Yeah. Because all they know is Yale. All they know is Yale and the base in Groton. The sub base in Groton. They know Yale and they know UConn, right? And that's about it.
And the casinos.
Definitely.
Foxwoods, Mohegan.
Right.
Yeah.
And then they know about some of the bad things about the state, but most people don't know, you know, that we're a state rich in talent and rich in musical prowess. So we're gonna get down to the bottom of that. So how was it growing up here? Like, we're not a known area; we're a small state.
So for me, I grew up in two parts of Connecticut. Okay, I was born in New Haven, Connecticut.
Me too.
But moved Yale, right? Moved to West Haven when I was like 2 or 3. So I spent a lot of my younger years in West Haven, Connecticut. Mm-hmm. I moved out of West Haven when I was like 14, 15.
Oh, wow.
Back to New Haven, Connecticut. Okay. So I was raised with a good cultural blend.
Did you go to Hill House or West Haven High?
Both.
Both. Wow.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. So like my freshman year was at West Haven High. So a lot of people that not from Connecticut may not understand West Haven High was like, when I was coming up, it was predominantly a white school.
Absolutely.
My predominantly mom was there too. White town, like, you know, West Haven was known.
It was the burbs.
It was the burbs. So, you know, my cultural influences coming up were, you know, all kind of music. You know, I listened to 80s pop, rock, you know, like
made
all
you diverse.
That. Plus. Yeah, then I had the hip hop, then I had the church, then I went to a white church growing up as well too. So I have that influence, you know what I'm saying, musically and creatively as well.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, then being from a black church, because my grandfather was black pastor, you know, all that. So the influences for me was like a big, just like pot of gumbo of all kind of cultures, musically, just, you know, just everything, musically, spiritually, culturally. My friends, I had, you know, a rainbow of friends, you know what I'm saying? Black, white, Hispanic, Africans, Mexicans. It's like, that's how I grew up. So, you know, it was very...
people don't know that it's very diverse in Connecticut, right?
Very diverse.
You would think it was predominantly, you know, a Caucasian state, but no, we're a melting pot, you know?
Yeah, very
more
diverse.
So, more so than the South, you know, up North, there's more diversity, more different kinds of food, different...
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Yeah, you don't see that many... you don't see that in the South as much.
No, not as much. So I definitely was exposed to a lot, you know, a lot of different cultures just growing up, period.
Yeah, and that put together for your makeup.
Yeah, it, who I am.
Right. So was there a strong musical presence growing up?
Definitely. My maternal grandfather was a musician, singer. Wow. My maternal grandmother sang. My paternal grandmother, a musician. My paternal grandfather was a musician. My father's a musician. You know, it was just like, just came on down the line, kind of, you know, just in my blood.
Yeah. See, I see you post that a lot, like it's in your DNA, like music chose you.
Yeah, always, because people ask me, especially, I'll never forget when I'm, you know, growing up in elementary, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I'm going to be a musician. That's
really,
all I knew. In kindergarten, I like.
Because I was going to ask you that question. If you weren't a producer, a musician, what would you be? And you always knew since kindergarten.
Her name was Miss Cheryl.
Wow, Miss Cheryl.
I'll never forget. Kindergarten. True, you know, they do that. What do you want to be when you grow up? You have to draw it and stand up in front of the class to hold the picture. I drew a guitar and some drums. It was I'm going to be a musician. Yeah. So there's never been any other thought of doing or being anything else in my mind. All I've ever known my entire life was music.
So how were you introduced to it? Just from your family, everybody, just your grandparents?
Just growing up. Growing up in church, you know, coming up, you know, my father, he was a little on the strict side, so he didn't allow, you know, certain type of music. In the house, we would have to sneak and listen to, you know.
I know all about that.
I got older, in my teenage years, and going to school, being exposed to, you know, different friends, you know, I start to listen and hear different, you know, kind of music. But like in the house, music was played every day. My mother was singer, you know, my father, every day, like music was always playing on the record, on the 45 or 12 inch, you know.
Vinyl.
Nobody know about, we didn't have CDs and nobody even do CDs no more. We didn't have playlists and streaming and all that. We had vinyl, you know what I mean? My grandfather, he had one of those, it was like a 6-7 foot record player. Like, it was furniture, but it was a record player too. It was like 6-7 foot
the console, the big console.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
So always would have that playing when I went to my grandfather's house. So, you know, music was just a part of my life every day.
Yeah, yeah, I remember that joint. It would have the A-track in it, it would have the cassette, yeah, and it would have the record player on top. And then when it broke, we would leave it in the house and put the TV on top.
As furniture.
It was a TV stand, too. Oh, man. So how did you choose your first instrument? What was your first instrument?
My first instrument was drums.
Okay.
And it's funny because me and my mother were talking about this just a couple of days ago. And she said she remember how before I could walk, I was crawling.
Yeah.
I would crawl to the cabinets and pull out like pots and pans.
Get out of here. Wow.
Go get the magazines from the living room, mm-hmm. get a couple of pens or spoons or whatever I can find. Make a drum set and, and play. And she said how my grandfather, because, you got the mean aunt, put the stuff away.
Yeah,
my grandfather would leave that boy alone. I'm trying to tell y'all one day. He used to say that, leave that boy alone, let him do what he do.
Yeah.
Like, literally. And like at a young, before I could walk, I wasn't just beating, I was creating rhythms.
Wow.
You know,
the gift
at a young age. So so it was like, I really, like I always say, I didn't choose music. It chose me. I really didn't have a choice in the game.
Yeah. That's similar to me too. My mom said my first steps were I left her lap and walked to the drums at church.
Wow.
Yeah.
See?
She said that was my first steps. Yeah. She said it was destined. That's crazy, bro.
Yeah.
So drums in what order? And then guitar or keys? What's next?
Interesting. So it was drums.
Mm-hmm.
And then guitar, because my father was a guitar player.
Nice. Okay.
Here's the funny thing though about that. I'm a lefty. I'm left-handed.
Yeah. Right.
So my father's a right-handed guitar player.
Whenever he would
do a chord, he tried to teach me. He'd strum a chord. He'd pass the guitar to me. I'd automatically was trying to figure out his chords. I never forget the day as a kid. I didn't understand it, but as an adult, it just makes me laugh. Mm-hmm. And one day I did it. He's like, son, I ain't going to be the help. You got to do this on your own.
You got to do it on your own, yeah.
I can't show you left-handed chords from a right-hand position. Like, he even went as far, they tried to get me a guitar that was left-handed, but mm-hmm. the strings were, in the right direction. Like,
exactly,
the E on top. Mm-hmm. I couldn't play it.
No.
I couldn't play it. I had to play a right-handed guitar upside down.
Wow.
And so it was drums, guitar, then the bass. And then a family friend, a white dude, we were going to the white church. He was mm-hmm. like, hey, man, I got an old violin I don't want. You guys mind if I give it to your son? I feel like, he can, benefit from it. I'm like, yeah, sure. So,
dude, that was one of my questions. Oh, my gosh. Go ahead.
Yeah. So he gave me a violin and my mother and I was having this discussion the other day too. She's like, I remember when you went upstairs, we was downstairs talking and laughing. And she said, I came downstairs within 15 minutes and was playing the songs and melodies on a violin.
Yeah.
So it was just like, a natural progression, like any instrument I really picked up,
So it is true that you played a violin. Cause I was going to ask you, there was a rumor growing up, right? So I didn't even get to do my intro, but the myth of Troy Oliver, right? I'm from a city called Bridgeport, right? So Bridgeport is about 25 miles south of New Haven.
Mm-hmm.
Down I-95, growing up in gospel, we all heard of each other, but sometimes didn't get to see each other till we were adults. Like, because playing in church, our churches were fellowship. And so we would go to different churches and there would be concerts. By the time I got teenage years, I could go out, travel with my Uncle Ricky or... if there was a big concert going on, my mom or my uncle would bring me to the concert to see people. So maybe by the time I got to be 18, my gospel choir started traveling with my high school. And then maybe by the time I'm 21, I'm out traveling and I'm playing professionally now. And the myth of Troy Oliver was that this dude played a million instruments. And that he didn't have a band, but he could play by himself and sound so full. So we go to Agape. Shout out to Aaron Moody and Bishop Moody. And we go to Agape, and you're playing with your praise team. And dude, you had a loop, a drummer, he's playing organ, and you was playing key bass on the keyboard. And it was the craziest thing I had ever heard because you sound like a whole band, dog. And it was just like, yo, that's Troy. That's Troy. Because we had never met you. So we were about 18 or 19. That's Troy. That's Troy. That's him. That's everybody. Everybody was telling me. So, like, your legend preceded us meeting you, man. And it was so dope to finally see you and meet you and then finally meet you and know that how cool you were. So that's the myth of Troy Oliver, man, that it had come down I-95 that this dude could play all these instruments. Now, how many instruments do you play?
Total, I think it's like 5 or 6.
That's amazing.
Five or six. Bass, keys, drums, violin, cello, bass, lead guitar. Yeah.
Wow. That's amazing. Pretty all much. Self-taught, basically?
Yeah. Pretty much.
That's dope.
Yeah.
So coming up the way we came up, PK style, your grandfather was a pastor, your dad was a pastor, you know, like how important is it to pay your dues? Do you feel like that's still necessary for musicians to learn some type of work ethic and pay dues?
Absolutely. Paying dues is a part of the process. Without paying dues, you won't appreciate, you know, if you're fortunate to get to the pinnacle or to have successful moments. Without paying dues, you know, one, you won't appreciate it, and two, it's easier to lose that position.
Right.
Because you don't understand what it took to get there, and you feel like, you know, people owe you versus you earned it, you know.
Yeah.
Being old and earning are two totally different things, you know. And this is another thing that freaked a lot of people out when I tell them this. So I've been in the music industry. I'm coming up on celebrating like 25 years officially in the music industry.
Wow.
And throughout the 25 years, I've never left church.
That's another question I was going to ask you, but go ahead. Let's go.
I've always been on somebody's organ or somebody's keyboard on Sunday morning. I've never got to the place where like, I don't need to play in church no more.
So, dog, why though? Like, this is amazing to me. And I just want to hear, I know already, but I just want to hear you tell the people. With all the success, Grammy nominations, Billboard Awards, you know, like multi-platinum, all the plaques in your music room. Mm-hmm. Why do you feel the urge to still come and play on it, sit on somebody's dusty organ every Sunday?
For me, because part of it is my roots.
Yeah.
It's just like, I can't separate from it. Of course, I love God.
Absolutely.
People may find that hard to believe. Not yet. I love God.
Yeah.
And I know where my giftings come from.
Yes.
And for me, it's like I felt like I had to stay connected to the church to keep me rooted and humbled and grounded. This is no cap. I mean, I got years and years of stories, but there's plenty of times I'd be in the studio with Jennifer Lopez till 3-4 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday, drive 2 hours from Manhattan to New London and be sitting on an organ on Sunday morning doing regular praise and worship. You know, no knock against them saying the praise and worship with regular praise and worship folk.
Absolutely. Yeah.
They have no idea where I just came from.
Where you came from.
You know, I'm following orders. If the choir director be like, break, you know, or stop, a musician, whatever. Hey, you in charge. I'm in my position.
That's amazing, man. It definitely keeps you humble, right? It definitely keeps you, but it helps you to acknowledge where your gift came from, like you said.
Yeah, absolutely. I think
there's a couple other people, like I think Beethoven does it, you know, like he still plays at church. It's just wild, like you guys with all the success and all this money, you know, all these accolades, and you still, you know, humble yourself and come serve the Lord. That's super dope.
I got to, and that's a part of the reason why I never went on the road. Like I never went on tour. I had plenty of opportunities to get on tour. I'm just keeping the buck. I know, so for me, there's levels to this when it comes to musicianship. You know, you got the church musician, then you got the church musician that can, you know, go out a little bit, then you got the church musician that can tour, do local gigs. You got the guys that elevate to professional, you know, artists and start touring and all that stuff. I never perfected my craft to the touring level because I was so caught up in the production and the creative part of it. Like, I'm like, I don't want to tour. I'm going to stay here in the studio. So could I go on tour? Can I do it? Yeah, I can.
Of course.
But I know I know the hours that it takes that you got to learn music and lines and memorize. I'm like, yeah, I'm not about to do all that. I can't.
Yeah.
The road is not for me. I'd rather stay here in the studio and just be creative and be productive. But like far as the elevation of just learning music and being creative and being a musician in the church definitely, it keeps you relevant because, you know, I'm an R&B producer. That's my number one thing. Right. Although I can produce whatever, R&B is my, that's where my bread and butter is.
Absolutely.
You know, it's strongly church influenced.
Absolutely, like, yeah. Right.
You know, chord progressions and, absolutely, you know, it's strongly church influenced. You know, we write from, you know, what we know from our heart, you know. And so the ability to stay grounded, the ability to stay humble, for me, I would say it was, I want to say kind of easy, kind of, because it was like, I know if I don't stay in church, I'm going to be a mess.
Yeah, okay.
Listen, I was in church. So how about this? Let's keep it buck. Stayed in church, never left the church, still got 9 kids. You feel me? Now imagine if I wasn't in church.
Lord Jesus. You're a blessed man. I called you Father Abraham before. Father.
I mean, granted, I was married a couple of times, you know, so, you know, whatever. But at the same time, you know, church just kept me, you know, not just church, but God, you know what I'm saying? Being able to submit and not just to the Lord, but to people that he chose to lead me. You know what I mean? It's just different.
Yeah. Man, I mean, you are blessed. You have a beautiful family and you have an amazing gift, and every good and perfect thing comes from God, right? So we know that it all came from him. And I can imagine that's what keeps you grounded and keeps you wanting to continue to serve because, you know, he gave it to you. The same God that gave it to you could take it away, right? So we were taught that at an early age, and it's in our makeup. So you playing in church on Sundays at your family's church. What's the name of your family's church?
Growing up, it was True Light Deliverance Center.
True Light
on Dixwell Avenue.
Dixwell, wow.
Yeah, Reverend Lonnie Talley.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah. And so you played there. That's where you cut your chops. That's where you kind of learned everything.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, then to expand, living in West Haven, you know, I also played in a couple of white churches too.
Really?
So, yeah, I learned the white culture. So there was a church, Faith Christian Church on Campbell Avenue.
Yeah, okay.
In West Haven. You know, we had transitioned for a little while, and I ended up playing there. You know,
wow.
I'm like 9, 10, 11 years old. Wow. And that back then, that was like considered a mega church.
I'm sure, yeah.
The nice size church, you know, and it's my first time like on a major stage, you know.
Playing mains or just like?
No, drums.
Drums. Drums, okay, cool. Okay.
Drums, yeah. I learned, so growing up in black churches, you know pocket, but you don't really learn pocket until you get in the white church.
Like,
absolutely, yeah. They ain't impressed with all the tricks and stuff. No, so it definitely, you know, the culture, it trained me.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. So from there, and then to at what age did you start playing keys?
I think my first time on keys, I was like 12, 13, and it was a dare. A commercial came on TV, and my brother was like, I bet you can't play that melody. And we had a little keyboard situation upstairs. I was like, I bet you I can.
Yeah.
So I went upstairs and figured it out. And from there, that was it.
So you're 12 or 13, and then how do you progress into really wanting to do it and be a keyboard player?
It was just, it was like a natural flow.
Mm-hmm.
It was like the challenge of learning music. The challenge of learning songs on the radio, and you know, cousins will come over, or my friends will come over, and be like, "Ooh, can you play this? Can you play this song? I bet you can't play this." And it was like the challenge of learning it. It just like it made me excited, like man. Okay. So
that's dope.
Yeah. So it was a natural progression.
Wow, I get it. So from at that point, how do you become skilled? Like, at what age do you realize that I have a gift and I'm kind of good at this?
I don't know if I ever got to that point.
Still to this day?
Still to this day.
Stop it.
I'm my biggest critic. I am my biggest critic. Like, So I learned how to play in church by playing my aunt's church, my Aunt Marie, Deliverance Haven in Middletown.
Okay.
I had been playing keys maybe all of 2 or 3 months.
Okay.
And they're like, come on up, baby. I need a keyboard player. I'm like, I don't know how to play though. I literally learned how to play praise, well, devotion back then.
Yeah.
Like, and it wasn't, it wasn't no transpose on the keyboard.
No.
I had Casio, it wasn't no transpose on that. So wherever they were singing, I had to figure it out, like playing the bass, the melody, the chord. Yeah. Like, I learned how to play in church.
What age were you then?
Like 14, 15.
14, 15, okay.
14, and I didn't have fortunately, I didn't have like an older.
I was about to ask you, did you have any mentors or anybody you looked to, like, I want to be like him?
Bars, like
music influences.
I played drums for Willa at Agape first.
Okay.
And then I used to play bass for her.
Wow.
So when I transitioned to keys and I became older, like 16, 17, I started playing for Bishop Moody. And she definitely influenced me and taught me a lot.
She played too, that's right, yeah.
Yeah. And it was a lot of older musicians around town that, you know, when they would see me, you know, I would try to learn and glean from them. Mm-hmm. But I never had that like one solid person that, cause, you know, I was all over playing all different churches. You know, when you were young, you just trying to get that $75, $100.
That manila envelope, Doc.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I'm with you.
So, you know, we playing, different churches, but definitely Bishop Moody. And I can say, you know, God rest his soul, Martin Parker, like,
Martin,
you know what I'm
saying?
He showed me some stuff, like, you know what I mean? Just when I would see older musicians, or even like musicians my age that I felt like more advanced to me, like Pastor Rob Smith. Mm-hmm. Like, we went to Hill House together.
Yeah.
You know, and I was more of a, I was so culturized with the white culture, with the R&B and a little bit black, you know, Rob straight church.
Straight church.
Yo, you got to show me what you're doing. Like, I need to know that. So, you know, I try to glean from everybody, you know, coming up, just like, especially on keys. Cause I mean, I could tell it now, it don't matter. When I was 14, 15 years old, it was like when people found out I can play, they was like, oh, I need you. I was 14, 15 playing in clubs. And they were sneaking me in through the back door.
Yeah.
I'd get on stage, do the set. You know, when it's time to break, I had to go back out, sit in the car or whatever, you know. But I'm learning top 40s, you know what I'm saying, at 15 years old playing in the clubs.
Yeah.
So I had a very diverse background.
Yeah. So that made you well-rounded, though, right? It definitely prepared you for the next wave of your life, right?
Definitely.
So, fast forward to adulthood, right? How did you get into production? What made you want to learn about production?
So I didn't even realize what producing was until I was like 15, 16. Cousin of mine, Abel Mason, we call ourselves having a little gospel group called Foundation. we went to a couple of churches, you know, try to sing whatever.
Yeah.
But, you know, we had a little bit of equipment and, you know, just studying other groups and acts and stuff, you know, I learned that, you know, what my responsibility was in the group to not just play, but, you know, create, you know, the drum patterns, the bass lines, the keys, you know, and being around him, coming up with him, like, he definitely showed me, like, yo, listen to this. You see how they did that? Or check out that melody. Oh, you see how the bass line is moving? You know what I'm saying? We need to start doing. So I literally, like, studied.
Yeah.
Like, so like around the age of 15, my age of 16 was my first time in the studio. Okay. I went to Vic's Horizon.
Shout out to Vic at Horizon. That's what's up.
You feel me? Campbell Lab, first time. Yep. And that's, he had an engineering at the time. I think the dude's name was Nathan. Was nice, like real, real dope young dude up and coming. And we literally was creating on the spot in the studio, like, we didn't go in there with no equipment. We used all of Vic's equipment, like his drum machines. We got in there, you know what I'm saying, tapping out on the drum machine, bass lines, all of that. Like, and just like, that's when I learned, like, okay. And it was that moment, my first time in the studio, I knew, all right, this is what I want to do.
That's amazing. So what was your first setup like? How did you get your equipment? And then what was your first setup like, your first production setup?
So, the first equipment that I had that was official prior to the Yamahas and the Casios that people would give me.
Yeah.
So, look, I got to tell the real story. So okay. My first setup was like a Casio keyboard. Okay. I had one speaker and I had two cassette tape recorders.
Okay.
And so I would do the drums, record it live on the cassette.
Yeah.
Play that to the next cassette, add bounce the bass.
Yeah.
Do it again, add the key. That was my first.
I know all about that with the four track. You know, you only have four tracks, so you got to be creative with it. My boy Adam Askew was a legend with that. I don't know how he would.
Yeah, I mean,
16 tracks.
I don't know how he did it to this day. Even then, before I had a four track, I used to go between two tape cassettes,
two cassette
players, and we had to tap the drums out for 3-4 minutes to tap on the bass line, everything. Like,
you was it a loop, or did you have to play for 3 or 4 minutes?
Play it all the way through. It was a cassette. You can't loop a cassette. Like, you got to play that all the way through.
Locked in, everything.
And, you know, I'm saying when the group or the crew will come over or friends or whatever come over, I'm like, yo, check out this beat I made. You know what I'm saying? It'd be real airy and real spacey because you know recording like 8 times back and forth, but you can hear the beat.
You can hear the beat.
You know, growing up, my family called me, my nickname when my family's Black. My family called me Black. Like, yo, Black, that's hot. That's hard. Black, that's hot. I like that. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I started. You know, that was my first wave.
Yeah.
Cassette tape. Then dope. You know, getting older, being in a group. You know, there was my cousin Abel. He was able to convince an investor to invest in us. His doctor by the name of Robert Stern. Dr. Stern invested in us.
Shout out to Dr. Stern.
Yeah. And he got us an ASR-10.
Ooh.
A Roland JV-80.
Whoa.
And an Alesis SR-16 drum machine.
Yeah.
So at the age of like 17, that was my first setup.
That's amazing. Wow, that's cool.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, you couldn't tell us nothing.
Yeah, y'all was lit.
We thought we was Teddy and Aaron. You can tell us not.
That's major professional equipment though, still being used today.
Yep, and with a four track. You know what I'm saying? Had a four track recorder, and that was our first setup.
Yeah, and so from that, you got your taste of producing, and then so when did you give? Let's talk about the shopping. How long did you produce to get good? Because in that period, you know, you're not always ready. You think you were? How long did it take for you to get professional, to get that professional sound?
I think it took me, so the advantage that I had being a musician, I was surrounded by musicians. I was always, you know, because Abel played the bass, like, you know, we were our biggest critics. Like, coming around musicians, like, you got to be on top of your game.
Absolutely.
It wasn't until, and we recorded a few records prior to this, but it was the one trip that we took to Indianapolis. I'm going to tell the story. It's all right. It's years ago. I was in high school.
Yeah.
I think my senior year in high school. And somehow or another, Abel connected with this producer out of Indianapolis named Steve Huff. You know Steve Huff?
Yeah.
So we drive out to Indianapolis, 11-hour ride. In the middle of school year, it wasn't no school vacation. I just left.
Oh my God.
So we went out there with our demos. We played in my demos and stuff, you know. And Steve had an official like studio set up out there. And so watching him, talking to him, and you know, he just schooled me like, you know, this is how you need to do it. And hearing the difference between what we were doing and what he was doing, that trip changed my life. It changed my life. I was like, oh. And Abel was one of them cats. Like, he'll clown you. Like, you say, you play your joint, and the drums is like, whatever. Then Steve, come on. He looking at you like,
yeah.
You hear that? Like, so it's like, that, you know what I'm saying? That type of, that one trick, it literally changed my whole aspect. And I was like, oh, this is where I have to be, like, creatively. Yeah. Like, and from that moment on, I was locked in. Like, you ain't got to tell me what. I already know what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
And I know what I need to do it.
Same thing happened to me with you. Do you remember this story?
No, for real? Wait.
Yeah. The same thing happened to me with you. Me and Dion had our production team. It was me, Dion, and Adam, and we were making tracks. And you gave us the opportunity to come play something for you at Sony.
So, I wasn't a jerk, was I?
No, you were fine. We you were real nice to us. We we stayed up all night, you know, putting together a playlist, a CD of our mm-hmm. best stuff. And, you know, as a musician, you always think you're better than you are a lot of times. You know, you don't necessarily know mm-hmm. what the industry standard is. You just know you can play. You know what, you try to listen to the radio and try to mimic it. Right. And so we didn't know the technical aspect about drums and EQing and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So we bring our CD, we put it in, and the whole thing is out of phase, and it's like freaking out your speakers and everything because the way we sampled the drums wasn't right. So you were real kind to us. You're like, yo, you got to fix that. You know, you're like, you, Gerald, Isaac, y'all all were very kind to us. All the people that were professional always let us know, you know, what we had to do. But we were young boys, 21, 20 years old. So we, you know, thought we was hot stuff, and you gave us an opportunity. Like, yeah, man, come play it. So we drove all the way to New York, came to Sony Studios, and played you a few joints. And you would tell us what you liked and what we needed to work on. And that's something I'll never forget because it inspired me. And it helped me get better and learn how to do things a certain way. So the same way you learned from Steve, we learned from you, bro. Yeah, so thank you for that. Yeah.
That's crazy.
And that was 20 years ago, at least.
Yeah, I'm going to say that. Yeah, at least 20 years ago. Yeah. And then maybe more, a little more.
A little more, probably, yeah.
Yeah, wow.
So when did you get your first placement? What's your first opportunity?
My first placement, ironically, that you mentioned his name. I had two placements at the same time. One I did with Gerald Isaac.
Oh, no.
Shout out, Gerald. With a group called Forecast.
Okay.
Song called I Try.
Okay.
And then simultaneously, maybe like a month or two apart, was a group called 7 Mile and a song called Do Your Thing.
Nice.
I did that. Corey Rooney wrote that. And so I didn't realize even at the moment how big it was, both of those moments. Yeah. I never realized until later on in my career, like my first two placements in the industry were both singles.
Yeah. Wow. You came out right out with the heat.
Both of them were singles. Yeah. Like, I Tried with a single Forecast. They shot a video. You can Google, YouTube it. You know what I'm saying? Do Your Thing with 7 Mile.
That was
Mile.
In 1998, bro. I just Googled it. 98. It was on RCA.
Yeah. And
crazy.
Do Your Thing came out same year.
Wow.
Same year. Yeah. So it was like, that year for me was like,
amazing.
You couldn't tell me I wasn't about to be the next.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I'm saying? Babyface or, you know. But, you know, it was still a long road from there. But those were my first placements, 1998.
Yeah.
Yep. The year my youngest son was born. Yep.
Wow. So you mentioned Corey Rooney. What does he mean to you in your career?
Corey, still a mentor. But Corey definitely was, he was vital. So I put like this. If it wasn't for Corey, there would be no Jennifer Lopez records, Ginuwine records. Like, Corey definitely was instrumental in signing me at Sony, you know, when I signed with Sony.
So, for those that don't know, explain who Corey is and what he does.
Corey Rooney, songwriter, producer, executive. You have to Google him. I can't even, like, his credits is just like
super long,
you know. Yeah, like Jennifer, Mark Anthony, like people you wouldn't even think Corey did. You know what I mean? It's like crazy. Like Corey got me in the room. Like a lot of people don't notice. You know, I worked with Hall & Oates before. Wow. You know, I did I did 4 days locked in with Hall & Oates. Wow. Like Corey, because I was a musician.
Yeah.
You know, and at the time I had a Rhodes. I had a Rhodes suitcase. You know what I'm saying? 76. Yeah. So my room, you know, Corey, he was a mentor, and he mentored me and taught me like the mechanics and the little intricacies of making records.
Yeah.
Like sonically what you need to do to capture people. Corey taught me the difference between hearing something and feeling something.
Yeah.
Like you could put a string pad in here. It doesn't have to be heard.
No.
But you could play it to where someone can feel it, and they don't even realize what's going on. It's like, oh, I did something about that.
Yeah.
So Corey, he taught me like little stuff like that. But, you know, I had my bass guitar, my guitar, my Rhodes, pianos, you know what I'm saying, MPC. That was my setup in the studio. And so, you know, they seen that. I was like, yo, you know, Hall & Oates is coming.
Yeah.
Lock in with them for 4 days. Lenny Kravitz is coming. Lock in with Lenny for 2 days. You know, Celine and Renee are coming in town for a week. We're going to lock you in with Celine for like, you know what I'm saying, 2 or 3 days. So
Celine Dion?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Wow.
Because of the gift I had, I was able to create like on the spot a lot, you know,
because you were prepared, right? You were prepared. Your journey had made you, brought you all the way up to this point. And so everything that you went through as a child and learning, you know, cutting your teeth and going through these situations where you were well-versed on all these instruments prepared you for this thing. That's what I wanted to, and we'll come back to Corey because he definitely deserves the praise. But like I mentioned earlier that you are a member of the 100% Club. And I saw this on a Drink Champs interview with Tank. Okay. And shout out Tank the artist Tank. He mentioned that many people can't do what you guys do. And Tank is also a church boy as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
So the 100% Club consists of writing the record, producing the record, and singing the record. And many can't do that, you know? But the most people who can are from where? From church.
Church.
And R. Kelly, of course.
Yeah.
I believe Rob went to church with his grandmother or something. I don't know.
He did. Right.
But most people that are a member of that club are from church. And I just think church music, church makes the best entertainers in the world, man. And it's proven. The skill that we acquire from the rigorous activity of having to learn on the spot, we make the best musicians in the world. You could put anybody on any stage and they're not afraid. You know, they've been in worse situations. You know, like I played in arenas in different places, and I'm not afraid because you know why?
Right.
I played at church.
Somebody started singing a song in the key of A.
Yeah.
A song I ain't never heard before. And now, you know, you had to play something.
You had to figure it out.
Because the whole church looking at you, they ain't looking at the person, they're looking at you like, you know what I mean? So, on the spot. And it's a little storefront church. And you feel more pressure in the little storefront.
You feel more pressure in that setting than you do in these atmospheres. Yo, you ain't lying, bro. Because that setting prepared us for where we are now, and especially where you are today. And that's amazing. Yeah. So shout out to Corey Rooney, man.
Shout out, C. Rooney.
For giving you that opportunity and teach you the game, man. How is the game different now than then?
It's crazy because that's an oxymoron.
Okay.
It's different in a lot of ways, and in a lot of ways, it's the same.
Okay.
You know what I mean? It's different. I would say, the most significant and obvious difference is how people receive music nowadays.
Yes.
Like, you know, no more CDs. It's all streaming and downloading. Corey was an executive at Sony under Tommy Mottola. Corey signed me with the permission from Tommy.
Yeah.
But Tommy called me at my house. I'll never forget it. Tommy called me. He's like, I never got the call. I'm living in the projects. Hey, Troy, this is the barber at Tommy's office. You got Tommy speaking to Tommy? I'm like, Tommy who? I got Tommy speaking to Tommy. Tommy was like, hey, Troy, we love you. Da da da. We want you to sign. All right. Fast forward. So maybe like 2 years after being signed, Tommy called us in the office, Corey and all the producers that were on it. Like, listen, this is when Napster came out. So listen, we got to make all the money we need to make within the next 2 or 3 years because the industry is going to take a shift and the money's not going to be there.
Yeah.
So whatever you do, go hard, do it now. Grind, don't stop. The landscape of the industry is changing. And that was in like 2002, like when Napster first came out, whenever all that stuff, you know.
Yeah. And for those that don't know, Napster was a website where you could download music. It was a bootleg kind of site where you would download. Yeah.
It was the first one.
Steal music. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it would destroy your computer because the viruses would come. But go ahead, bro.
So it was like Tommy was a prophet. Because come 2004, 2005, 2006, the industry took a hit heavy for years, you know, until they figured out how to, you know, get all that. But, you know, so from that aspect, the industry is different. It's how we receive music. Creatively, I think it's still kind of the same as far as how I approach it.
Mm-hmm.
you know, it's funny because you still get the same calls. Like, I would get calls back then, you know, let's say Mary J had a dope record, or Jodeci's record, or somebody had a dope record. Yo, Troy, we need a record like this. I need a record like, still getting them same calls.
Still today, yeah.
Oh, I need a record like that blast. Or, oh, you got something like her? Like, so
yeah.
It's still the same, that aspect wise. Of course, sonically it changed because time has changed and the instruments has changed. And
of course, yeah.
When I first started going to, this is a major way it changed. When I first started going to New York, I was getting on a train with an MPC 3000 and a hard case.
Yeah.
No, and one of them hard cases.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I had I had a Motif in a robe case. You know, it wasn't
hardware.
Book bags. Yeah. Book bags wasn't popping then. So I had no book bag. And I had like my rack, you know what I'm saying, on my racks. And, you know.
Yeah. Yep.
So I'm getting on the train. Yeah. I'm getting on the train, all that. Plus my clothes. So whenever I went to the studio, until I was able to buy a car, I'm on the train, then I was forced to buy a car, I'm traveling with all my gear. Keyboards, racks, drum machines. You know what I'm saying? Now, all you need is a laptop.
All you need is a laptop, bro.
And a controller. You don't even need a Yamaha. You just need a controller.
You just need a controller, bro. It's totally different. I remember those days of lugging an NPC across the country, going through the airport.
Yeah.
You know, like, I remember carrying keyboards and loading buses and stuff. Now it's just like a laptop and you plug and play. Amazing.
And all the things that are in the racks are now in the laptop. So that's another way it changed. You know, we went through the phase where the money wasn't really what it was. And, you know, I always tell people there's mountains and valleys in the music industry. And if you can hang on through the valley, you know, you'll eventually get to the mountain.
That's dope.
We lose a lot of people in the valley.
Yeah.
You know, well, valley.
It's not made for everybody, right? It's not a journey that everybody's supposed to make. And so that's why we salute you for enduring 25 years professionally in this game, man. That's super dope. We praise you, and that's why everybody's online. Shout out to everybody online watching the interview right now. I see our boy Richie White is on here. That's your godbrother, right?
That's my cousin. That's my cousin.
Yeah.
Shout out. What up, cuz? More like a brother.
Absolutely. He's fam. Yeah. Shout out to everybody that's watching right now. James Carney, Eric Davis, Rodney Davis on here. Wow. Everybody.
Oh, that's all them the homies from back home.
You know it. The killers.
Monsters. You just made a bunch of monsters right there.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Deion Tyson is on here. Yeah. Shout out to everybody watching, man. Getting this free game from our guy, Troy Oliver, super producer, Troy Oliver. So what's three things that you need to make a record right now?
That I need, or someone in general?
That you need. This is about you.
To make a record? My laptop, one.
Yeah.
A dope writer.
Mm-hmm.
And a microphone.
Right.
Like, literally. It's literally that simple. Like, so this is one thing that I have. I'm not biased. I have the ability to be non-biased, especially to myself.
Mm-hmm.
Can I write? Yeah, I can write. But I know, like, today's music, you know, I'll give my input. But I'd rather have a writer that is more youthful, like you had mentioned earlier, like it's a young man's game, you know, that youthful pen, the melodies, the cadences, you know, how you flow, being able to break down a verse between the chorus and the pre-chorus and all that stuff. And literally just someone that can just deliver melodically, but at the same time be simple enough for the consumer to understand and be able to sing along with the song.
Right.
You know, one thing I've always told church musicians is, like, you got to be successful in this game, you got to be able to dumb it down.
Mm, talk about it. Help us, man.
Because most church musicians are very skilled
in
playing with his keys.
They have good ideas, right? They have good ideas, but it's just too much.
Dope ideas.
It's
a flood. Like, I literally had to learn. Like, the biggest record I ever made was Differences. And it's probably the easiest chord progression you'll ever hear.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
4-3-2-4-5-6.
Yeah.
You know, and it's really a three finger chord.
Yeah.
You know, when you're playing church, you know, you gotta, like,
the super spread.
You know, the left hand gotta be it. It doesn't take all that.
Yeah.
You know, and I had to learn how to just, like, one time, it was a couple of sessions, I, like, just left my left hand in my pocket. and just like, I'm working the drum machine, everything with one hand.
Yeah.
Just to like literally train myself, like, it don't take, you don't got to do all that.
No.
You know, you have too much, not only do you have enough equipment to substitute what it is you're trying to do, it's like the consumer, they don't care about a dope. They don't care about no line or no bass line or no run you did or the scale you just did with that piano. They don't care about that.
No.
You know what I'm saying? They really just want to be able to sing along to the song. The drums hit hard.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? And the melody, musically good enough, dope enough that it'll catch their attention.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? For them to listen to the song. Mm-hmm. Like, it just got to be catchy. It don't got to be difficult.
Wow. It got to be memorable, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You hear it in your sleep, like something real catchy. So I always, like, I tell them, it's like, you don't need tritones.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't need to do like ninths and major sevenths over. Like, you go in the key of C and do a three finger chord progression, bro, you got to hit.
Yeah. Like, so talk literally. To me about these, like, so that's the difference, right? You're a pure musician, right? Skilled, but wise enough to be able to dumb it down. Talk about the difference between a beat maker and a producer, because this is the era we in with this whole trap era and you know, the way music is going right now. Beat maker versus producer.
For me, you know, I'm an OG in the game.
Mm-hmm.
This is one thing Corey taught me, and Troy Taylor too, another mentor. Shout out to him.
Shout out big bro Troy Taylor, yeah.
He's
like a legend.
Yeah. He's a slave master in the studio. But I learned from them. Like, so for me, a beat maker make the beat, you know, and that's another thing different about music now and then. I can send it out.
Oh yeah.
I don't have to go to LA to work with you.
No.
I can stay in Atlanta and just send you the record and, you know.
When was the last time you had a session? I will come back to the beat maker, but when was the last time you had a session with the actual artist?
Well, I've tried to bring that back. So
okay.
I've been working with Drew Sidora. I don't know if you know her. She's on the
Housewives. Yeah, I see her. Real Housewives, right?
Yeah. So I've had her come into my house studio. Like, I'm like, if you're in Atlanta and you're an artist, I'm working with you, we're getting in the studio.
Absolutely.
I'm not doing that, sending no music no more.
No.
Like, if you're LA, like, we'll figure it out, whatever. You're out of state. But if you're an artist and you're in Atlanta, you're coming to my house and we're going to work.
We're
going to
work, yeah.
The way. Definitely. We're gonna vibe, like it's a different vibe.
Mm-hmm.
It just makes the music that much
the chemistry,
more relatable.
Right.
Yeah, and the feeling, like you can, it comes across in the music. So yeah, I've been working with Drew for like the last few months. So she comes here. Case, I did a couple of records with Case. He came here. So you know, this is like y'all come here. I don't want to send music out like that no more.
Wow, really?
Yeah, if you're in Atlanta, you gotta come here. If you up and coming, you knew whatever, you gotta come in. My niece, Amira Dudley, I love her. Shout out to her. She's up and coming. She's 18. Boy, her pen is like, she fire. But you come in here, niece. We gonna do it the old school way. Like,
yeah.
Let's get in. I did a session with K Michelle a few weeks ago with my boy Hero. Demetrius,
yeah, Hero.
Shout out Hero. He put me in on a K Michelle. You know,
Hero's dope. Shout out Hero.
Yeah, he was dope. Yeah.
Demetrius Hero Sims.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm just trying to, I like being in the studio.
Yeah, the chemistry is there.
Yeah.
All right, so back to beat maker versus producer.
So beat maker, you make the beat, you make the track, you send it out, you know, that's it. That's all you have to do with it.
It might have a loop on it, a sample, some
loop, you know, you might have a loop sample, you might throw something together, da da da. Now, and I want to make sure I make the distinction.
Yeah.
Very clear. Because I don't want to make anyone feel slighted. For me, a producer, a producer is like you're a parent to the track or the song.
Mm-hmm.
You create the track, the music, or you're hands-on in the creation of it. You're hands-on in the writing. You have input, you know, melodies, hooks, words, lyrics, the structure
right.
of the song, where
structure
the hook goes,
the song, right.
you know, all that. Once the song is complete, you have everything to do with the mixing of the song. Yo, turn the drums up. Yo, put some mm-hmm. compression on that. You know, take the lows off that. You know, then in the mastering of the song. So basically, you follow the song from birth,
yeah.
from beginning of it to the song is complete and ready for the radio. A beat maker is just going to give you a beat and get his check. Yeah. You know, he has nothing to do with the mixing, nothing to do with the writing.
But then he calls himself a producer, doesn't he?
Some people do, but you could call yourself a producer, but if you don't follow it all the way through, like, I'm not going to let no track leave my studio, and I don't have any input on it throughout the whole entire process, because at the beginning of the day, that's my music. I got to make sure it's well represented.
Yeah. A lot of these known and wealthy beat makers are getting these producer tags and titles, and they're not able to see the whole record through. They're bringing in a team, but then they're still getting production credit and you know, executive production even on something. So
this is the argument we used to have back. Some people would say, you know, Puffy's not a producer. He doesn't play an instrument. How could Puffy be a producer? I said, you could only make a statement like that if you haven't been in the studio with Puff Daddy.
Right.
Puffy, can he play an instrument? No.
No.
But Puffy can hear. Mm-hmm. Oh, I call him Puffy. We call him Diddy, whatever. He can hear, and he could tell. I've been in the studio. Yo, turn that kick up. Put the hi-hat right here. Make the pattern go boom, boom, back. Even though he can't play, he articulated. Yeah. When the writer's coming and writing, he's right there with the writers. Now, I don't like that. Do this with that word. Make the cadence do this or the melody.
Yeah.
After all that's done, the engineer, he in there. Yo, put a drop right there. Turn the kick up. He sees
that's producing. It's producing, yeah.
He's a producer.
Mm-hmm.
He sees the record all the way through. Like,
yeah.
And most beat makers, like I said, I don't want anyone to feel slighted. You don't have to be technically a musician to be a producer.
No.
You know, you just have to have musical knowledge and be able to hear and know what's right and what's not right. You know, you got to have, you know, very skilled sonic ears, basically. Yeah.
I think my main concern was just these kids that have these laptops and they're just playing with Fruity Loops and they're buying these packs and, you know, slapping these layers on, you know what I mean? Slapping these layers on top of a loop and they're calling themselves a producer or a DJ. And it's just like, no, because if you strip away everything that you added, could you recreate it on your own? Could you make the song? And so that's why that 100%, you know, the JDs of the world that can make the beat, that can write the record, that can, you know, produce the song, you know, they're valuable and they're few and far between. And I salute you for being a part of that club, bro.
Appreciate that.
Yes, sir. So do you like where music is heading now? And do you feel like real R&B is coming back?
I love where music is headed.
Okay.
Because I'm a musician first and I love creativity. All creativity. I don't feel like R&B ever left. I don't think R&B, I don't think people are saying, oh, that's real R&B. Or R&B's coming back. R&B never left. It's just, it didn't have the platform or the stage that it once had.
Okay.
If any, you know, anybody that's a true R&B head or R&B musician or producer or writer, we know, we understand, we never left. We've always been here.
Yeah.
So the reemergence may seem like a reemergence or we're coming back, but we ain't never left.
Yeah.
We stayed working. We stayed grinding when hip hop took the forefront.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't even realize a lot of the hip hop records were being produced. It had R&B musicians samples, in the studio, you know, church musicians in the studio playing the melodies over the hip hop records and sampling R&B songs and making them. You know what I mean? Hip hop records. I think my personal opinion, I just had his name and it just, Bryson Tiller.
Okay.
That first Bryson Tiller record, in my opinion, was the like, oh, we can do R&B and rap. Like, we can wait. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He introduced it in a way to like, so that made like people like singing again.
Mm-hmm.
If I can, you saying
kind of Drake that, first, right? It was Drake first.
Yeah, Drake. But yeah, I like nothing against Drake. I love Drake.
No, nothing against Drake.
I like the rapper Drake more than the singer Drake. Just me personally.
Yeah, you know,
Drake did it, but for me, the Bryson Tiller record, because Bryson Tiller, the music was more you know, his the samples that he chose,
drum
patterns.
It was very musical. Yeah.
Yeah, he was very, and you know, Drake wasn't doing no runs. He was just saying, you know, Bryson threw a little,
little, put some sauce on it.
Yeah. So for me, I was like, you know what I'm saying? Drake did his thing, but Bryson for me made it for R&B. Drake made it cool and popular to sing, but Bryson made it, he gave it that soul. Like, he brought the soul back into it.
I got you.
To make it for, like, you know, R&B singers to now, like, you could do an R&B song as long as your drums is right. Oh, you good.
Yeah. Okay. That's dope. So you like the way the music is, where R&B is headed right now, because it never went away to the true R&B heads.
Nah. Yeah, I love it. Like, all the new, the young up-and-coming singers, and, like, I'm horrible with names. I'll be forgetting names. Like, I like Blast, Lucky Day. Man, you ever heard Lucky Day live?
Lucky Day is incredible, bro. Ooh. I just said, if he comes this way, I got to make sure I go.
Oh, he's a killer. Like, live? Incredible. Like, you know what I mean?
Shout out, like, D-Miles, too.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Hers, the Scissors, the, you know, the Kalanis, you know what I'm saying? All these type R&B, for me, it has never really died. And I feel like you still have your Troy Taylors, you still have your Tanks, you know, you still have your Troy Olivers, like, you know, you still got OGs in the game that are not only still producing, creating, but, you know, now, like, if you follow Troy Taylor, he ain't got nothing but young guns and hitters, you know what I'm saying? Like, but they listen, you know what I'm saying? You train them, and you know what I'm saying? And it's like, you get, once you're able to, I'll say, artist develop, or producer develop, or writer develop, you get someone young that's willing to listen to the guidance, and someone that's been in the game. I still call Troy and Corey for advice, or insight, send a track back. What you think about this? You know what I mean? And I got plaques.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I got plaques. And but I still call my mentors for that guidance, that mentorship. You know what I'm saying? I just believe everybody needs a mentor. I don't care what stage in your life. You always got to have somebody that, you know, checks and balances. And both of them will quickly be like, Troy, especially, whack. Or they won't even respond. When they don't respond, you know, like,
you already know. Jeez.
It's been like 3 days. You check your test message. Like, did you?
Dang, you ain't say nothing.
All right. Oh, say less. Goodness. But, like, you know, it's checks and balances. I just feel like where it's going now, it's in a great place because musicianship is, again, appreciated.
Yeah. You get to play on your bridge. You get to play on your bridge a little bit, stretch. You know, you get to work on that melody, you throw that sign lead on there, just a taste, you know, just a little bit to make it feel good. So I know what you mean.
You see what I'm saying? The musicianship of R&B is being appreciated again. So if anything, I think, went away, it was that. Like, I love the fact that I have creative freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Still pocket, but creative freedom, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And doing chord progressions and the sounds that I choose.
Because
nowadays, I can go crazy and just do sounds and keyboards and synths and bass lines and all that. But I can make it a loop.
Yeah. Okay.
Make it an 8-bar, throw a filter on it.
Yeah.
Throw it to the breeze. You know what I mean? They throw some jumps on it. Woo! Oh, now we got a record. You know what I mean?
A record. So it's like,
it's so many different ways to do it now. Like, I have in my iTunes now, and in my hard drive, I have loops that I create.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I do full tracks, and then I just do loops.
Wow.
So it's just like, you know what I'm saying? Just, if I work with an artist or a writer, like, you want to hear full tracks or you want to hear loops?
Yeah.
Or when I send stuff out, you want loops or you want full tracks?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? A lot of writers like loops. For those of you who may not know, a loop is just a chord progression minus the drums and minus changes. Just, you know, just either piano or Rhodes or guitar loop.
Something to write to.
Yeah, just it's basically a naked track. And it gives the writer more creativity, availability to just throw harmonies and do whatever. And then we do what we call post work, is after they do that, we'll come back and throw the drums, maybe a bass line on it. So, you know, and loops, you know, as well as I do right now, loops, that's what it is right now.
Yeah,
everybody doing loops. You know, I'm going to create a loop pack and start selling them.
Let's do it. Yeah, you heard it here first. Troy Oliver pack coming.
Got a lot of loops. Yeah.
Let's go. I need some sounds too. Let's go. So we're talking about all your victories. Have you ever had any, have you ever been burnt in the industry? Because I think it's important. And if you haven't, praise God, you know, that's dope. But I think in music, it's important to share. I think Troy Taylor has been talking about passing on experience, you know, telling the next generation, like you alluded to, about what they did and how to do it and keeping R&B alive and also sharing experiences and stories. So have you, you don't have to go into detail, but have you ever had an experience where you didn't come out as the victor?
So I had to change my verbiage. I learned. I don't say I was burned.
Okay.
Or I don't say I was cheated or I was jerked or robbed.
Yeah.
I say I was ignorant.
Okay. And that's huge.
I say that because it's called the music business.
Absolutely.
And the biggest word out of those two is business.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, unfortunately, it's more business than it is music.
Mm.
So to my ignorance as a young person, when I first got in the game, I signed a couple of deals that weren't in my favor. But looking at the circumstances at the time, I was 20 something in my 20s, mid early 20s. I had a wife, I had some kids, you know, I had responsibilities. Mm-hmm. Only money I was getting was from church on Sundays, that, you know, saying my $200 in church on Sundays. I try to work a little job in between, but it just didn't work out. Like, you know, I tried, mm-hmm. you know, I did, but it didn't work. So, you know, when somebody offer you $400,000,
mm.
you know what I'm saying? And yeah. you're like, what? $400,000? Where do I sign? You know what I'm saying? I didn't really have the guidance and leadership or even the mentorship of someone like, hold up, let's read the fine print.
Yeah.
You know, I learned, you know, in my first publishing deal, I signed, you know, it was a $500,000 deal,
wow.
you know, in my 20s, you know what I mean? I was
20s.
Young, $500,000 deal, you know.
In the early 2000s, right?
Early 2000s. Yeah. I'm like, what am I supposed to, you know what I mean? Like,
who's going to say no to that? Take that. Yeah.
Of course, I find out years later after being in a situation that the way they had it set up is if I had more than 4 songs on one album, so I've had 4 songs or more on one album, my rate would drop.
Mm.
So I would get less money.
Yeah.
And it didn't make sense to me when I figured out what it was. And I also that's when I learned you can split a penny. I didn't even know you split a penny. Like,
yeah,
you know,
I didn't know how that was possible. I heard that too, yeah.
Right inside, I was like, wait, split a penny 9 ways? How are we splitting a penny? You can't split no penny. It's 1 cent.
It's 1 cent.
You know what I'm saying? So I learned all that by the deals that I signed. I didn't have the intelligence or even the guidance to really know and look through them before I signed them. So I don't even fault the record labels or anybody that had anything to do with it. I fault myself for not having the wisdom.
Because,
you know, was I taken advantage of? Some people would say so, but I would say it was to my ignorance as well too.
Yeah.
Because I was just so anxious and so ready to get out the hood and make sure my family.
No, that's a lot of money, bro. It coming where we come from, I can understand that's a lot of money. And you're excited, you're happy that you finally got your, you know, your opportunity and you're ready to go. But like you said, you know, you probably weren't ready for that situation.
Yeah. Prepared. I'll tell you a true story about Tommy, and it's a true story. I don't know. So when, you know, remember I told you earlier, he gave me a call at the house.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason why he called me, because they wanted me to sign exclusively to Sony.
Okay.
And I was being a little hesitant at first, because that word exclusive made me nervous. Like, you know, I knew that much.
Yeah, right.
So Tommy called, like, listen, man, we just want you, you know, we appreciate what you do. Da 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 da. I was like, but you know, I just want to be able to work with artists that are not just on Sony, but you know, he's like, listen, we just want first dibs on whatever you do. Like any music you create, we want first dibs. And you know, if we don't like it, you know, go do what you want to do. I was like, okay, that's fair. That was a production deal. That wasn't even published. That was a whole separate deal. That was another $400,000. That was a whole other deal.
So you had a publishing deal and a production deal.
Yeah, you know.
You was caking, bro.
So you get half up front. Yeah. On production, though, you know, you got half up front, and then you get the balance on the delivery of
the records.
You're saying, yes. The masters, yeah. So I did my deal for like $15,000 a track. So they gave me 20 times 15 up front, mm-hmm. and then the balance, you know, thereafter. No, 20 times 7 because it was 15,000 a track, and then the balance after. So we work, you know, we working, and nobody knew. I didn't even know that I was going to take off as fast as I did. Mm-hmm. Like, my first record at the gate was I'm Real with Jennifer. That, you know, when we did the remix with Ja Rule and them, that mm-hmm. thing just went. And it was like, oh, snap. He got a sound.
Yeah.
And so phone calls start coming in from other record labels, other artists.
Yeah.
Yo, we want that, you know. And then after that, you know, differences come out. So the phone is going sick. Then Rough Ends come out with Someone to Love You. And then Jenny from the Block. So I was on the road getting a lot of calls.
Wait, you did Someone to Love You?
Yeah, of course. You know, I did Someone to Love You?
I thought you did. How many records did you do on the album?
I did two. I did one called Sure Thing. And I did
Sure Thing. Someone to Love You. I didn't know. Yo, you did Someone to Love You?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I only thought it was Short Thing. Oh my God. I know Mike and Nate are on that album too.
Yep.
But yo, that's crazy. Okay, go ahead. I don't want to stop you, but that's an amazing record.
So yeah, so you know, doing all these records and records is coming out and working with all these Sony artists. And so I'm getting calls from other record labels because, you know, I'm on the radio, I'm on the charts.
Yeah.
So I'm like, bet. I'm like, yeah, what are you doing? I'm telling my manager at the time, Prince Market D, God rest his soul, Mark Morales. I'm like, yo. Mm-hmm. Tommy said, as long as I let them hear it first, we good.
Yeah.
First call we got, I forgot who it was. I don't know if it was Whitney. It was somebody. No, it was Janet. She heard a record that I did on a Jennifer album.
Janet Jackson?
It was never a single. It wasn't a single. It was just a song on the record called Secretly. It was a piano ballad that I actually wrote and mm-hmm. produced. Corey wrote it with me too, and Janet heard it, was like, I need that, I want something like that. So we called Tommy, like, yo. He was like, no.
Oh my god, what? Because he had Mariah.
No, we had Mariah at the time. Mariah was gone.
Oh,
he had Jennifer. But it was like, and that became the norm. Like, every time I wanted somebody to call, it was always no.
He would put you on freeze to keep you exclusive. You was their Kanye. They didn't want you going out. You was the heat maker.
And
man.
I was so distraught because I was like,
they were stunting your growth.
When you call my house, that you would let me work with other people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That is crazy, bro.
So that period of my life, and it was so.
How many years you think?
Crazy. It seemed like forever, but it wasn't long. It was like 3-4 year period, like 2-3 year period. Cause I don't know if you remember this, you old enough to remember this. When Tommy left Sony, mm-hmm. they walked him out the building.
Yeah.
So Tommy left. I think Corey hung around for like another year or two and then he left eventually, but I was still there under that same contract.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Locked in.
Still couldn't work with other. I'm mm-hmm. still stuck. And he's gone.
Dang.
And here's where it got real bad. Nobody in Sony wanted to touch me. Pause.
Yeah.
Because I was under the Tommy regime.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
They were like, nah, you part of Tommy camp. Corey camp, man. We ain't.
Oh, so they thought you was bad news. Dang. So you kind of got blackballed from a relationship.
Tommy was like known as a tyrant a little bit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So like once he was gone, it was like ding dong, which is dead, which is dead. So like anybody affiliated with him, I caught the so for years I didn't even get a placement. Because no one would it wasn't like I didn't have the ability or the skills. No one would want to touch me because I was under Tommy's regime. And I couldn't work with people outside of Sony because I was still stuck under this exclusive contract. So it was like, I was so stuck.
What are you attested to? Was it your lawyers, or was it just, did you have somebody look over paperwork, or did you, were you just happy?
I was young when I signed the contract. It was my ignorance.
Okay.
Because this is where I messed up at when I signed that first contract. I signed a contract with Sony. My lawyer worked for the same law firm that Sony had.
They was all tied in together. So they said, we got this contract for you, and we got these lawyers for you, and they all worked together.
Using lawyer. Now, mind you, he was a young, new, up-and-coming lawyer, but he was on the bottom of the floor. Like, I never forget, the law firm was a whole building in Manhattan, and it was like, but he was on the bottom floor, so I had to go to the basement. Mm-hmm. I mean, he had a little office in the corner of the basement. We met. He went over contact with me. I'm not thinking, like, you shouldn't be using a lawyer associated, because any lawyer outside of that would have never let me sign exclusively.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, this is, don't ever do this. Like, but because it was a lawyer officiated, you know what I'm saying, connected to who Sony was using at the time, I just knew I was getting checked. And
and it was amazing money, but they halted what they really could have gave you.
Yeah.
They stunted your growth.
And and at the time, in true honesty, nobody knew I was going to take off the way I did, how fast as I did. Nobody, like, you skilled, you know, you got talent, you know, you got potential, you'll make some records, but nobody knew it was going to be at the level and as quickly as it happened. Like, it was like, I signed a contract and 2 months later I had a hit record.
Yeah.
It was like crazy like that.
Yeah. And that made you sought after, but they didn't want to let you go.
Pretty much.
We were so proud of you at home, too. Everybody on here, I mean, we all were super proud of you to be from Connecticut, to hear these records on the radio and hear that sound and just be able to see you at church or see you in the street or at the mall, anything, you know, like, we were just proud that, you know, and especially all our New Haven brothers, because definitely they all looked up to you. You know, you were the big homie for them. And so we were so grateful that we had another person in name that was from our small state. That was making noise in the industry. And like, we have a lot of guys from our little state that
literally.
I mean, Troy Oliver, Troy Taylor, Doobie Powell, Mike Clemens, Jonathan DuBose. Like, you could run it down.
Dion.
Like, from my generation, Dion, and you got Billy and Kevin.
Billy,
And now you got Smoke and you got The Breed now. You got Aaron and Rashad.
Rashad
coming out, like, making noise in the industry, like platinum plaques, like, this is so dope from our home little state. You know, Aaron used to play in a task force. You know what I mean? Like, and to see him to go from that to, you know, a superstar producer is amazing. So shout out to you and your team. Do you have a team or are you still working solo?
I'm solo, but I have a team.
Okay.
So my team is Troy Taylor, still Core Rooney. I'm still under both of those umbrellas.
Okay.
And the Breed, like, those are my little brothers. Like, YA, you know what I'm saying? That's my squad. You know, I don't, and that's pretty much
that's the family squad. Too, though. It's
They like fam. Like, when they moved down here, like, they hope they don't mind me telling this. Like, when they first moved out here, they stayed with me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm like, y'all don't worry about that. Just don't worry about no place. Just get here.
Just
come
here,
stay here. Just come down here. Y'all just come in. You know what I'm saying? We'll figure everything else out later. But yeah, that's pretty much my squad right there.
That's, you know what I'm saying?
I have people that I work with, but for me, a team is, I'm saying, someone that you work with consistently and you can rely on. Like, I know if I send the Breed a loop or idea, I know it's gonna come back. I know it's gonna come back fine.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I'm saying? And vice versa, like, damn, yep, yo, they call me dog. Your dog, throw a bass on this. Your dog needs some guitar on this. Your dog, do your things on this. Throw some keys on this. Like, you know, that's how we flow.
Wow, that's dope. And you just found a formula and it works and keep going.
Yeah, pretty much, man. They grind, but they put the grind. They paid their dues.
Yeah, they definitely did. Like, I remember in the beginning. Definitely. I remember hearing in the beginning.
They were living in New Haven. I was living in Windsor, but my studio was in Terreville. Like an hour, 15, 20 minute ride for them. Yeah. They're making that drive every night.
Yeah.
Snowstorms, sleep, you know what I'm saying?
When you're hungry, you go after it, man. I remember sleeping in the studio, like, literally for days, you know, not telling my mother I'm not coming home, you know, for a couple days and just just working. It's the grind. And I think
yeah.
a lot of people don't realize, you know, what it takes to make it.
You have to sacrifice. You have to go through some pain. It has to be a birthing process.
Yeah, absolutely.
In this industry, there has to be a moment, a season, a time where you have to, like, I would call it the crossroad. Come to a moment, it's like, either I'm going to quit or mm-hmm. I'm going to push forward. Like, one of them is that moment when you face, like, I can't do this no more or I can't stop.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's when you get to the place, but when you make that decision to go for it, that's when you realize, okay, it was worth it. I'm glad I pushed for it. You know what I mean? It ain't always easy. Like, if you've been, I don't know anybody in this business that don't have, quote unquote, a horror story, that ain't signed a bad contract, ain't had a bad experience, a tour, or I mm-hmm. don't know anybody that don't have a story. Like, everybody got a story on some level.
Everybody got a story.
Or stories, period. Yes. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Like, and here's the thing. Gospel, R&B, mm-hmm. pop, hip-hop, country, everybody got a story. I don't care what genre of music you've been in. Everybody has went through some things, you know what I mean, to get to where they are.
Yeah, that is so true, man. But it makes it worthwhile when you have success, you know, because you went through that journey. So all the things you went through brought you to this moment where you can be celebrated. And, you know, we're here celebrating you now, bro. Let's talk about networking. You've been in some iconic sessions. I just want to poise the people on how to carry themselves. Is the artist your friend?
When you first get in the session, I say nothing.
Yeah.
If I don't know the artist, we just meeting, the only thing they hear me say is, how you doing? Nice to meet you. I'm Trey Oliver. I sit back to this day.
Yeah.
I sit back and I play my role. I'm mm-hmm. quiet in church mouth. I don't make no noise. When I'm called upon to do my job, I'll do my job.
Yeah.
And as the session progresses, you know, mm-hmm. we loosen up a little bit. Laugh here, tell a couple of jokes, be creative, then the bond is built, you know, and then you can be more vocal. Yeah. But when I walk in a session, I don't say nothing. Yeah. I'm quiet.
That's good. How important is it to network in these settings to make alliances?
Networking is, I would say, vital to your career.
Yeah.
The longevity and the success of your career. Case in point. Back when in my Sony days, we would have the Aaron Boys. What was it called back then? I forgot what we called them.
Runners?
Runners or something. Yeah, running, something like that. You know,
interns.
Interns. Mm-hmm. You know, young people coming from college that want to learn, you know, that want to be engineers or really want to be producers, but they start out on an engineering level. Gophers. That's what we used to call them.
Gophers,
They would gopher. Dudes that could engineer or produce or whatever, but mm-hmm. it was running back and forth to the store, getting snacks, getting food.
Absolutely, you want,
Mr. Oliver, da da da. You know, 20 years ago, you know what I'm saying. Now, the same dude that was a gopher is an executive over at Ariston. And because I didn't treat him, you know what I'm saying, as a peasant.
Yeah,
and I maintained a relationship with him down through the years. Now I can walk into the executive's office. Yo, man, so good to see you, man. Oh, man, it's been, yo, man, I remember when I used to go get your sandwiches. And, you know what I mean? Versus me being a jerk.
Yeah.
Back then, you know what I'm saying? That was networking. Yeah. That was building a relationship. Because one thing, you never know who going to be who in this industry.
You don't.
You never know who going to turn out to be the next. You just never know.
Yeah.
So it's vitally important to network. And I always say, treat people with respect, man. Just like, I don't understand people that, I don't like people that are arrogant and treat people nasty and mean and rude. That's not me. That's not my character. Because you never know who that person going to be 2 years from now.
Absolutely. Well, it goes against, you know, treat people the way you want to be treated, right? And
that's
another notch on your belt for longevity, because everybody that I talk to, everybody that knows you says you're a nice person. Usually they say nice guys don't finish last, but I don't think so. I think there are a lot of jerks that are in powerful places, but I think the people that have long careers, those people have good morals. And I think, you know, salute to you again for being one of those people, because You're right. You don't know who you meet 20 years later could be your advance or your demise, you know?
Literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah.
That's the game, though.
That is the game. All right. You dropped so many gems, bro. Let's play a game.
Okay.
This game is called Rapid Fire. So I'm gonna give you an either or, and you just tell me what your choice is. All right.
Okay.
Nothing crazy. Right. Just fun stuff. So let's do analog or digital.
Ooh. When recording or instrument?
Recording.
Analog.
You like the warm sound?
Analog all day.
Okay. So you record it digital, then you run it through tape.
Analog.
Yeah, analog. Okay. Akai or machine?
Akai.
The MPC 2000, 3000, or 4000?
I got to choose one out of three?
Yeah, one out of three.
Mm. The three, unlimited, the black one.
The black 3000?
The Roger Lynn. Yeah.
The Roger Lynn drum. Yeah. I'm gonna get one before Jesus comes back.
Yeah.
Hit Factory, New York or LA?
New York, hands down.
Okay. Hit Factory, New York or Sony Studios, where you made all your hits?
That's tough.
Both historic buildings, man. I know you had some crazy sessions in there.
In both of them. Wow. Ooh, that's tough. I don't know.
Can't pick one?
I would say Sony.
Sony? Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Miami or Houston?
Miami.
New York or LA?
20 years ago, New York. Today, LA.
LA, right. I know you love LA. Logic or Pro Tools?
Logic,
okay. Italian food or Spanish food?
Ooh.
You a food connoisseur. For those of y'all who don't know, Troy, if y'all follow his page, he loves food. He's a foodie, man. So, like, my guy eats at the finest restaurants, and I'm always texting him, like, yo, where's that? And me and Sherry are always looking at social media, like, you see Troy's plate? So Troy is a foodie, man. So, what are we doing? Italian? We're from the Northeast. See, we're missing a lot of that stuff down here because back home, you know, ain't nothing like that down here. So we're going Italian or Spanish food?
I gotta go Italian.
Italian, okay.
Right.
Surf and turf or soul food? Seafood and steak or soul food?
Surf and turf.
You that guy. Okay. Mm-hmm. Pizza or Chinese?
Pizza, hands down.
Guitar or keys?
Guitar.
Guitar. Wow.
It's my favorite instrument.
Really? That's amazing.
Yeah, I love guitar.
That's dope. Let's go. Let's see. Nike or Adidas?
Nike.
Celtics or Lakers?
Lakers.
Yamaha, Nord, Korg, or Roland, the big four.
I got all of them in here too.
If you needed a weapon,
you would think based off my room, mm-hmm. it was Korg, but yeah. I would have to go Yamaha.
Yamaha, okay.
Yeah.
All right. What season is your favorite?
Fall in Connecticut.
Layers, because I was gonna say summer fashion or winter fashion, coats and boots or short sneakers and tees.
Coats and boots.
You like my wife? My wife loves layers, bro.
Yeah,
she put a scarf on in a minute. I got you. Okay, Patriots or Cowboys?
Patriots. That's the easiest one you asked me.
No, you're a Patriots fan. I had to mess with you. All right. Do you prefer writing the song or producing the track?
Producing the track.
Yeah. Producing the
giving
track.
Giving the writer the inspiration to write.
Mm. So what do you hear first? I mean, I know it varies, but do you hear a beat first? Do you hear a pattern or chord patch?
For me, most of the time, it's chords. I hear the chord, the melody first before the beat.
Do you tell the writer or do you let the writer make the melody? So you make these tracks.
I always give writer freedom. The writers go for it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. All right, Taylor, are you on here? You ready, Tay? We're gonna play a game. Another game. It's called Respect My Catalog. And I'm gonna play a record, and you gotta tell me a story from that record, or tell me some background about the record, something you produced.
Okay. All right. That's cool.
Taylor, you ready? Track one. Tell me about that record, I'm Real, Bro, by Jennifer Lopez.
So that was the remix, actually, okay, to the original.
Okay.
The original I'm Real was another sample that I did with DJ LES.
DJ LES, shout out LES.
Remember LES?
Mm-hmm.
We did that, and we sent it over to, I can't think, Irv Gotti and them. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And you know, going back and forth, you know, production wise, and niggas took the sample and that's pretty much it. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Real simple. And that was in what, 01, right?
Yep, 01.
Yeah. 01.
That was the one that broke the
That was your first your big hit, your first one.
Yep, yeah.
Okay. Let's go to the next record, Tay, please. Shout out to Taylor, my cousin. She's helping me.
Oh, okay.
What song is this, y'all? Type it in the comments. This man's a legend.
It's in the G.
Oh. Yeah, I mean, this is a classic hit. Shout out to you, bro. Also, I think you were Billboard staff named you or named this song one of the top 50 songs of the 21st century.
That's nuts, R&B songs.
One of the top 50 R&B songs of the 21st century. That's a classic record, bro.
Yeah, definitely classic.
People saying they had no idea. To this day, people saying they had no idea you did this record.
Really? Yeah.
They've been under a rock, huh?
Imagine you from Connecticut. Everybody knows. True story about this record. I'll never forget it. I was on my way to the studio. We was working out of a studio in Long Island called Lobo Studio. And I was actually on my way to work with G. He was in town for like a week.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just listening to the radio, Hot 97 time, listening to the radio, trying to get inspired, just get some inspiration. And I'm just like, just hearing all kind of listening to hip hop and the R&B, everything that they're playing. And when we get in the studio, you know, back then I was a little younger, you know, I used to partake in some different type of libations.
Libations.
You know, we had, you know, a little Hennessy, a little whatever. But so G got in there, he came in and it was our first time meeting.
Wow.
And we just vibed, we clicked. And he was just telling stories about, like, you know, he had just recently lost his. So a lot of people don't know. What story is about his mother?
Wow.
He's talking to his mom. If you pay attention to the lyrics, there's nothing real sexual, nothing real sensual. My whole life has changed since you came in. You know what I'm saying? Dude, back then. He's really talking about his mom because his mom just passed. His father had died. And he was just in a real different place.
Yeah.
And so I never forget, I was in the studio. I did that on my roads.
Yeah, suitcase, I can hear it. Yeah.
Real roads. and I was playing with the melody, and he walked in the room, and I was just about to switch it up. He's like, yo, what's that?
Keep that.
And so I just played it through, and like we literally did that song. We produced it and wrote it all in one night at the same time. Like
the first night you met him. Wow. That's a great story. Wow. So the first night you met him, you created that record, you were playing around, and he said, keep it, and then you just from there made the record.
I remember walking out the studio for the first, because it was one of those studios with the bathroom, we had a kitchen, everything was, I didn't have to leave the room.
Yeah.
But we didn't have windows to the outside.
Okay.
When I walked out the studio, when I walked in, it was daytime. When I walked out, it was turning morning again.
Yeah. I remember those
days.
There
was no concept of time. Like, I didn't realize we was in there that long.
That long,
It was just like, It was a dope vibe, crazy vibe. We did like 8 records that week. Four of them made the album, but we did like 8,
But that one record changed the game, man. And it was so simple, right? Yeah. So simple, but still so tasteful. Simple. Yeah.
So simple.
And I think you guys fooled us with the, because it's attributed as a love song, but we're not thinking it's a tribute to his mom and like him speaking about his mother.
Nah. Yeah.
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 That's the power of music, man. It's multiple facets, right?
Another story about that song is I didn't like that video. I remember when the video came out, I was like, what was Hype thinking? He got you floating in a chair in the middle of the sky. Like, what is this? I thought the record was going to flop because the video, I felt like it was like bad video. But, you know, when do I know?
Hype was creative with his approach to different things here.
Go back and watch that video and pay attention. You'll be like, wait, what? The video has nothing to do with the song.
Also, the name of the song, right? Everybody, when I asked them what the name of the song was, everybody said, My Whole Life Has Changed.
My Whole Life Has Changed.
Nobody knows, because when you say differences, nobody knows the name of the song. So I think that's hilarious. Another story to go.
That was G's idea. Like, he was like, he wanted to take that one line, you made the difference in my life.
In my life.
So he called it Differences. We didn't argue about it, but I was like, okay, I don't know, but okay. Like,
because My Whole Life Has Changed is the phrase he says all the time.
Right.
You know? So, like, you were the key phrase, right? All right, let's go to the next record, Tay. If you're looking for closure, don't take it closer. No matter how hard we try, we can't say it's over. Keep going in circles. Keep going in circles. Talk to me about that record Trey. With Trigger Trey.
Oh, man. So I met Trey when he was 15 years old.
Wow.
Troy signed him when he was like 15, 16 years old. I'll never forget. I was in Hit Factory studio. Trey walked in. He's like, yo, my new artist. I'm about to sign him. Give me some tracks for him. I'm like, bet. Met him. We hung out. Gave him some tracks. They came back a few days later, played me some fire that Troy and Trey had did. And I was like, you know, when he was 15. So I've known Trey for a very, very, very long time. And ironically, I never had a chance to get on any of his records. You know, remember what I said earlier?
Yeah, about they had you locked up.
Contract.
Yeah.
So, you know, finally, you know, got free, whatever. But that Circles, that track I actually did in 2017.
So tell me what your involvement on you produced that track. You made the beat.
Yeah, I did the track. So it was, I'll never forget, I came back from L.A. It was one of my L.A. trips, and I was just inspired.
Yeah.
And I was just being creative, just like, I don't care. There's no, you know what I'm saying, no walls, no box. I'm just going to play what I feel.
Right.
And we switched up the drums. Troy Teller switched up the drums a little bit. Mm-hmm. But that track I did in 2017, and Breland, I don't know if you know Breland, the writer. He's a country artist now. Don't touch my truck. Got that song. Don't touch my truck.
Wow.
Breland's dope. He's such a dope writer. Him and Troy. I think Trey wrote it too. Like, it came out in 2020, I believe it was. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
the track was already 3 years old.
Wow. And that went platinum?
No, it was number Not one on one? Billboard.
Which
it,
one? Okay, that was
number one on Billboard. Yeah,
I saw
yeah,
you holding
yeah.
a Trey. Was it a Trey plaque for?
No, it was the that was it was Trey because it was the number one album on Billboard.
Oh, number one album on Billboard. Yeah, gotcha.
R&B. Yeah.
Super dope. So working with Troy Taylor, you had some opportunities, you know, to do some television stuff. Talk to us about that.
Yeah. Oh, Star, man. I know. I missed some Star checks.
My wife loves Star, bro. She loved that show.
It was so much fun. Again, creative freedom. Mm-hmm. Like I did, like, you know, I've got the opportunity through Troy, mm-hmm. who was working with Jonte Austin. He was the music supervisor over the, you know what I'm saying, the show. Mm-hmm. So working with Lee is like, is dope, but it ain't mm-hmm. easy because Lee is very particular about what he hears sonically and he knows what he wants. So it was a challenge every week. Mm-hmm. Every week, you know what I'm saying? Yo, we need something like this. Do something like this. Oh, we need something.
So y'all
like,
creating
you know?
fresh songs every week.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Wow. Absolutely. So we are locked in like a boot camp kind of situation?
The first time we all met, it was a boot camp situation. After that, I locked in from the house. Yeah. Like I was just like, Troy called me like, yo, I need such. Lee's looking for something like this. Lee needs Jonte wants this. Da da da. And that's how I went, literally.
New fresh joints every week. Wow.
Every
did
week.
You do something on Empire too?
I did something for Star that ended up being on Empire.
Oh, wow. That's cool. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I remember that. That's what made me ask because I remember you doing some Empire stuff and then Star, of course, that stuff was hot.
Yeah. Star was, I missed that show, man. I missed some checks on my host.
I'm sorry. I saw your IMDb account. I said, this man is official, boy. He getting that. them syndicated checks. That's what's up, man. Tay, let's skip that one. Let's go to number five.
What's this about to be?
Yeah, man, that was your super smash, Jenny from the Block. Talk to us about that iconic record,
Jenny from the Block. So we were working on the second album. Corey's like, listen, the first album's dope, da da da. I need you to take it up another notch, another level. Come down, lock in. I was in New York for like a week straight, 7 days, just in the studio, just working, vibing. And I heard it was a Beat Nuts hip hop record. I don't know if you remember Beat Nuts.
Mm-hmm, of course.
And so I found the original and I wanted to see, like, okay, what elements did they take? Because I'm going to take from the original. I didn't want to take from them. So I heard the original. And I'm like, I mean, I can play this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I played it.
Played it over.
From the motif, the bass. In fact, I got the bass actually from the Proteus.
The Proteus 2000.
Real Proteus 2000?
Yes.
The bass is from the Proteus 2000. I remember it was just a track. So I had like a DAT. Remember the DAT?
DAT tapes.
I gave Corey a DAT, like 20 joints, 20 tracks. And that was on it. And it stood out to me. Like, oh, yeah, this is dope. This is dope for Jennifer. So Andre Dale from Connecticut came up. Matter of fact, it was around this time of year. It was around my birthday time. Get it.
Nice.
I left track at the studio. It was at Hit Factor at the time. I left a dad at the studio. I said, yo, Dre, him and Antonio, they was all down there working. Like, y'all pick something out right, too. I'm saying it's all Jennifer stuff. It's all tracks that I approved for Jennifer. And my artist I had at the time, her name was Tasha Ramos. Fire. Mm-hmm. She's from Hartford, Connecticut.
CT,
that was her. That's her singing on the backgrounds.
Wow.
So, I know it's my birthday time because it's my son's birthday, and he's June 4th.
Okay. Right before
of course, I'm the ninth, and I was married at the time. My first wife, she threw a cookout for us. And I remember specifically, because I'm like, I don't want to share a cookout with my four-year-old son. Like, you know, like, back then, we used to turn up. Like, I'm not having a cookout with my four-year-old son. I'm trying to turn up.
Yeah.
Anyway, we had a cookout. I got the call. They're like, yo, we just did a banger for Jennifer. Listen to it. So they're playing it over the speaker. Mind you, I'm in Groton.
Yeah.
They're in New York. They had stayed up all night. I'm like, yo, bring it here. Bring it. I don't want to play. No, come.
So I want to hear it on my speakers. Yeah.
He drove from New York. I never got had an Expedition, the Green Expedition, sat on some 20s, had a killer system in it.
I remember
that. They brought it up. Remember that Green truck? Mm-hmm. They brought it up. I put it in. I was like, oh my God, pause. That was crucial. I played it. I'm like, wow, yo, this is crazy. And played it for Corey the next day.
Yeah, it was out of here.
Flew Jennifer in like 2 days later, cut it. Here's where it get even more crazy. So the record was done, right? It gets leaked on the radio.
Whoa. Who leaked it? Hot 97?
It got leaked on 93.7 in Connecticut.
Connecticut? Somebody, oh, your girl. One of her family members got it.
Check it. So I get called in the office that Monday. Spazzing on me. Somebody in your camp. Like Tommy going sick. Like, you guys, like they spazzing on me. I'm like, yo. So of course I called my camp. I'm spazzing on them. Like, yo, why y'all do this? Like they pleading the case. Oh, we didn't do it. We didn't leak it. So that was years ago. Yeah. Why I find out just recently, like 3 or 4 years ago, Tommy was the one that leaked the record.
Tommy Mottola leaked the record.
He leaked it to 93.7 in Connecticut. So it wouldn't be tied to him if he leaked it in New York.
Whoa.
But, yeah. Yep, he leaked the record.
Why did he leak it? What was the reasoning?
He was like, he felt like it was ready to go. He's like, we're not going to sit on this.
So
like,
he wanted to get the buzz going. Got you.
Yep, he got the buzz. And, you know, and he knew what he was doing because, you know what I'm saying, it took off.
Wow, he did. That was amazing, man. Yeah. Iconic record. Then, like, so what was your role on that record? And then what did the Trackmasters do?
So I was, of course, I produced it, the original producer. They basically came in and did like the scratches and all of the little like samples you hear in like the little vocal samples and stuff like that. Yeah.
Okay.
That's pretty much what they did. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Mm-hmm. That's dope, man. Iconic, man. I mean, like I said, it was another win for Connecticut. We were super hyped. Telling everybody that our brother, you know, did that record, man. We was super pumped to be from the same place you were to say, you know, our guy did that record. So, man, congrats and salute to you, appreciate man. It. Also, congratulations for your recent award that you won, the 2022 ASCAP Rhythm and Soul Award. For what you know about love with the Pop Smoke. Rest in peace to Pop Smoke.
Rest in peace.
How do you feel getting acclaim from a record that is 20 years old? It's amazing. That's the beautiful part about music, bro.
It is. Something Corey told me a long time ago. He said, always try to make classic records.
Timeless music, yeah.
He said, a classic record will have you eating for the rest of your life. He said, don't always be trendy. Don't always do what you hear on the radio. Write from your soul.
Yeah.
Organic.
Yeah.
He said, you'll eat for the rest of your life. And I can't tell you how many times that record's been sampled.
I was about to say, what's your favorite version? Because I watched an interview with James Entume. He was telling tell us how many times Juicy Fruit had been sampled. And, you know, he said he loved the Biggie version and he liked the Keisha Cole version. Mm-hmm. For you, you know, yes, song has been sampled a bunch of times. And I know at least I can name two with the G-Eazy version and then also with the Moneybag Yo version.
My favorite versions, the Moneybag Yo and the... Pop Smoke. I like Pop Smoke because Pop Smoke left it real organic. All they did was speed it up.
Yeah.
You ain't like that was it. It was really the record.
It really was the record. Yeah. Wow. That's dope, man. Salute to you for winning on, you know, like that timeless record that just won't die, man. You're so blessed, man. I think those hands are blessed, and anything you put your hands to, man, it's gonna keep living and growing, bro.
Yeah, definitely. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Let's play one final game, and then I'll let you go because I know the game is on. You're going to want to watch the game, catch a little bit of it. We're going to play Troy's Ultimate Set List, and out of all the records you've done, you got to pick 5 records that you love to make a set list or a playlist. Out of your records.
Okay. That's pretty much easy. You done played half of them already.
you got joints.
Definitely differences up there.
And they don't have to be hits. It just could be what means, you know, your favorite joints.
Differences is up there, definitely.
Differences, okay.
Someone to Love You is up there.
Oh, I got a love record.
That song, Secretly, I told you about.
Okay.
On Jennifer's album, I forgot which album that was. I think that was the J-Lo album. A song called Secretly. Song I did with Blue Cantrell.
Okay. I got to go check that one out.
It's called Risk It All, Blue
Risk
Cantrell.
Risk It All, okay.
Yeah, Charmel Cofield wrote it. Amazing.
Dope.
And number five, my favorite, I would have to say, I got so many that weren't singles, man. That's tough. That's a tough one. No, I have to say, song I did with Faith.
Wow. Faith. How was that? Were you in the studio with
her? With Troy Teller. Me, her, and Troy Teller in the studio years ago.
Mm-hmm.
This Ayanna Vizant had did a soundtrack to one of her books.
Yeah.
And his name of the song is called Back Where I Started.
Back Where I Started.
Wow. I'll never forget. It's in the key of C. Troy told me just do whatever. He's like, it's Faith. Because I asked him, like, what should I do? He's like, it's Faith.
She can do anything.
Do whatever. Just play. Yeah. Just play. Right. And I got in my creative bag and just like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's dope. That's dope. Y'all check these records out. This is Troy's Ultimate Set List. Thank you for your time, big bro. I have
Absolutely,
just one
man.
Final section to ask you. You're a family guy. How important is family to you?
Number one.
Yeah.
Number one. Family keeps you humble, keeps you grounded. I'm a big believer in, though, family is who you choose.
Okay.
Family isn't always... We're connected who we are, blood-wise and DNA.
Yeah.
But that doesn't always necessarily make you family.
Okay.
You know, I have people that I'm connected to that aren't, that do not have my DNA or my blood, but yeah. I consider them family, you know, brothers and sisters. So family, I believe, keeps me grounded, keeps me real, you know. Family don't see me as Troy Oliver producer. They be like, all right, nigga, whatever. Like, what time you showing up? What time you starting to grill up, nigga?
Yeah, right.
You know, that's dope. Yeah, that family for me is very important.
Not necessarily blood related, but it's what they mean to you. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. What advice would you give as mature Troy, what advice would you give young Troy?
Stay focused.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get distracted.
Yeah.
Don't let the distractions cause you to lose focus and go off track.
Yeah.
And keep doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Because young Troy is pretty focused.
Yeah.
Got a little distracted along the way, but he's pretty focused.
He made it.
Yeah.
Okay. And lastly, what does legacy mean to you, and how do you want to be remembered?
Legacy, man, it's important, man. I want to be remembered for who I really am, truly am.
Yeah.
You know, committed, faithful, to a fault sometimes, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Humble, creative, you know, giving heart, caring, you know, who I really am.
Yeah. You want people to see you for who you really are, caring individual. I got you, man.
Just say nice things about me. I'm not, and tell the truth. You know, if I was a jerk to you at some point in time, he was a jerk. You know, I could have been a jerk, you know.
And in that time,
you catch me on the right day, you know, you never know.
Well, bro, thank you so much. I one last question. I kind of stole this from another pod I saw, but who would you like me to interview next? And if you have a name, if I don't know the person already, can you introduce me to that person?
Who would I like you to interview next? Well, I mean, you're getting Troy Teller, so
hopefully.
I would say him definitely Kim, Corey, Bree, my circle.
Absolutely. Okay. You know? Well, we have to work that out. I definitely know the breed. I definitely work with those guys, but put a word in with Troy, see if we can get him in here, and then also, you know, Corey, the legend, and I would love to talk to him.
Corey's like a ghost right now, but yeah.
That's a wrap, big bro. Thank you so much, man. I'm so grateful to you, man. Enjoy your birthday. Everybody say happy birthday to Troy, man. You know, God has blessed you with an amazing life, an amazing story, and I'm grateful that you took the time to sit down with me, bro. Like I said, you're a legend from our hometown. and that legend transcends to the globe, bro. And you deserve to be saluted, man. And it's nothing but love and respect over here from your brother down the road, man. You know, we come all the way from Connecticut all the way to Georgia,
all
and
it's
still the same love.
Yeah.
Still the same love. So enjoy your day tomorrow, bro. And I appreciate you. Thank you so much for being a part of the In the Pocket with Chip G podcast, bro. Thank you so much.
No doubt, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you, everybody, for joining. And I'm so overwhelmed at the support of this podcast. Thank you, everyone, for coming together and spending your Wednesday night with me. Our next podcast will be coming up next week, I believe. Yes, Little John Roberts will be here for part two on Thursday, June 16th. So we'll be coming together to do part two of In the Pocket with Chip G, episode four, part two, with Little John Roberts, Emmy Award-winning drummer, music director, and adjunct professor for Berklee College of Music. He is a legend in the game, and he has a lot to tell us on part two of episode four. So be there next week, next Thursday at 8 p.m. Thank you all for coming out. Continue to find your niche. Continue to stay in the pocket. And I'll talk to you next week. God bless.